syncope is the first thing, whether it's a healthy as well as the unhealthy patients can develop a syncope. This is the commonest manifestation which is going to occur in the dental setup. Why this syncope is going to occur most of the time? The dental treatment itself is going to be the, what we call a painful procedure, and 90% to what we call 100% of patients always come to you with a fear in the mind. So that is nothing but the stress, either it could be a psychological, or when you are doing a work on the patient, the pain itself can cause the stress to the patient. So this stress is going to release the catecholamines in the body. So like catecholamines, the adrenal nodule is going to be released in the body. And in case if the patient is on the, what you call, on the dental chair, if the adrenal or what you call catecholamines are released, that is going to cause the peripheral vasodilatation. The peripheral vasodilatation is going to lead to the pooling of the blood in the limbs. So because of this, what happens, there are percent decreased venous return to the heart. And because of decreased venous return, there is less cardiac output. Because of less cardiac output, there is always a lack of blood supply, decrease of blood supply to the brain. And because of this, what you call the brain function is going to alter. Because the blood which is carrying to the brain, which is always contains the oxygen and the glucose, where which is, if that is deficient, the patient is going to have a syncope. Whereas the other organs, they can have a stored energy, whereas the brain cannot have a stored energy in the form of ATP. That's the reason we need to, what you call, the blood, continuous blood supply is very much required, like 750 ml per minute, that should be there. Whereas continuous blood supply is very much required. If the blood supply is reduced to the 550 ml or maybe 450 ml, where naturally the lack of this nutrients, that is glucose and oxygen, is going to be reduced, that itself is going to hinder the function of the brain. That's the reason always maintain the, what you call this, blood supply to the brain, that is maintained by this body. Whereas if the patient is on the, not on the dental chair, if it's on the common area, wherever, whenever like we tell that, oh, if you are fasting, then you're going to have a syncopal episode because of a lack of glucose in the blood. Or maybe if you're standing in the crowd, maybe that is going to cause what you call syncopal episode because of the less oxygen in the blood. Or maybe if you're standing for a longer period, the blood supply itself is not reaching the brain, maybe that is also causing a syncope. So when such thing happens, the nature is the one which is going to take care of the patient by just patient going to collapse onto the ground, so that the brain and the cardiac organs are at the same level. So the slowly the blood is reaching the brain and the patient is going to recover. Whereas this is not going to happen in the dental chair, because on the dental chair, the patient is sitting on the dental chair, whereas the patient will not be in a supine position. There's a reason that most of the time, whenever the patient is having a chance of a syncope, they are giving a, what you call your local anesthesia or doing extractions, or rather you should prefer to treat the patients in the, what you call, your semi-supine position, so that the chance of syncope is going to be reduced by the 60%. So treat the patients in the semi-supine position, or like you give a local anesthesia in the semi-supine position, and give the patient proper position and doing extractions, and later, immediately again, that supine position should be taken, so that the chance of syncope is going to be reduced. The syncopal episode is going to be very much common, whereas in case of young male, whereas it is very much uncommon in the females as well as the children. Whereas why this happens is because the children are going to be like express the stress in the form of crying or like shouting, whereas the females also going to be crying, so the chance of syncope will be less. Whereas when you are managing the adult, or what you call young adult male, yes, these patients should be observed from the sitting on the dental chair till the patient moves out of the dental chair. Definitely the patient will not have a syncope. So that's the reason you have to monitor the patient compulsorily and always try to treat the patient in the semi-supine position. And then whenever you syncopal episode develops, that is going to give a slight, what you call your hint, like the perspiration is going to be there, or a patient under anxiety, and better, like in those patients, when if it develops, immediately place the patient in the supine position and take a spirit of ammonia. So that is going to cause an irritation to the mucosa, that is going to, that irritation itself is going to cause an increase in the rate and depth of the respiration. So that's going to be helpful for patient to recover very fast. And maybe, you can do what you call the oxygen is always a better, because that is going to help the patient in recovering very fast. If the patient is slightly, what you call, your conscious, you can give a glucose to the patient. Otherwise, in case of a slightly unconscious patient, so maybe you have to think of giving a IV dextrose to the patient for recovery. Because as you know, the syncope episode only occurs whenever there is a shortage of oxygen as well as the, what you call, your lack of glucose and lack of blood supply to the brain. When you are keeping the patient in supine position, obviously the blood supply has to reach the brain, and naturally the oxygen is supplied and the glucose is supplied. If any of these three things are not happening, it means that there is a syncope is persisting, then it can lead to the unconsciousness. So that's the reason you should always give a glucose to the patient immediately, and then can ask the patient to what you call your oxygen to patient, so patient will recover fast. If at all the patient is not recovering with PCO management, maybe the patient, you have to look for the underlying systemic conditions. Still now, what are the things we have discussed? That should be coming into the picture. Suppose if this is our patient is on steroid, then you should think of giving a steroid to the patient. Suppose if the patient is having other asthma, definitely this patient immediately not go for a syncopal episode, but you have to go for what you call giving the oxygenation or maybe bronchodilator drug. Maybe what you call, as I told, this maybe a simple syncopal episode. If at all it persists, then it can be a unconsciousness. So in those patients, rather check immediately the pulse of the patient, blood pressure, and check for a saturation, and then start protecting the airway, then maybe you have to go for a vertical shift in the patient to the emergency center. So that's the reason you have to check for underlying medical conditions. That's the reason you have to, when you are taking a medical case history, then you have to know for or to check for an inquiry with all these conditions. This algorithm where we have to manage the patient in this ABC, what we tell, and then the monitor the patient, giving oxygenation, then wait for some time, give all these things, follow this algorithm when you are managing the patient, so that if the patient doesn't recover, check for the underlying diseases, and as per that one, definite treatment should be done, or shift the patient to the ICU where the definitive treatment can be given to the patient. And don't, whenever the syncope, the first one episode occurs, that body takes around 24 hours to come back to the normal physiology again. So there is an increased chances of a syncopal episode is going to be there. If one patient is undergoing syncope, maybe the another patient, adjacent patient also can undergo syncope. That's the reason. And don't ever force the patient to open the eyes or what you call, ask them to talk, because in case of syncopal episodes, patient rather prefer to take the rest, like where dryness of the throat is going to be there. And patient don't like to, like, will not be able to open the eyes. Rather, you as a doctor, like, you check all these things, what you call your pulse, blood pressure, saturation, that itself is a guarantees you that, yes, patient is fine. If at all the patient is not recovering, then you have to stimulate the patient by just pinching the earlobe or maybe giving what you call the painful, inducing the pain by your fist onto the sternum of the patient. If the patient is responding, then it means that patient is having a syncopal episode, only the patient is going to recover. If it is not recovering, it means definitely the patient is under doses stage or maybe it could lead to the unconsciousness. That's better to shift the patient into the ICU center. Whereas the picture says that is find the position of the patient or maybe what you call our spirit of ammonemia, where the simple manner of lifting the chin, that lifting the chin itself can, you can see this picture where you can easily what you call your airway is going to be opened up. This is a more than sufficient manner when you are managing the syncopal patients. Like on the dental setup, most of the time the patient will be the flexed, what you call their neck. So better to chin lift should be done. This manner is going to be the helpful when you are managing the syncopal patients. Maybe if the patient is not recovering, what you call it is taking more time, better to give a oxygenation to patient. Whereas using ambu bag and all, when you feel, when you come from there, yes, patient is going to be what you call an unconscious stage. Yes, the ambu bag usage should be done. And don't ever think of trying this, what you call oral trachea tube or nasal trachea tube. And that is, those things cannot be tolerated with a conscious patient. That is only possible in case of inserting these things in the unconscious patient. Because a conscious patient will not tolerate these things. Maybe the safest method is nasopharyngeal tube. The simple thing that is supplying a lubricant jelly out of this tube, it can be inserted to the nasal airway patient. And along with that, you can give an oxygen to the patient. And it will have a sufficient time to the, what you call, ICU center. These are least of these medications. Yes, these are very, very important. One has to get acquainted with these medications. That is, first is adrenaline, and the next is antihistamine. Next is steroid, that is in the form of a dexamethasone as well as hydrocortisone. And next one is analgesics. And next is, that is anti-angina, that is trinitroglycerin tablet should be there. And a bronchodilator, that is salbutamol. And a deriphyllin, that is injectable form, that has to be there in case for managed asthmatic patients. In case of an anti-epileptic, to manage that one, you need to have a diazepam. And the dextrose, that is injectable form, should be there. Then the oxygen, that is what we say, that's a type CE cylinder, because we need to shift the, we'll have a sufficient amount of oxygen till we shift the patient to the emergency. And nowadays, like this aspirin and aromatic ammonia, of course, that is the common aspirin and nifedipine are a non-injectable drug that is preferred or advised to keep in case like emergencies, because this is, if a patient develops the myocardial infarction on the chair, it is preferred to give aspirin that is not going to cause much damage to the patient, that is going to be beneficial to the patient. because it may take more time to shift the patient to the hospital. Before that, if you give aspirin, that is going to be really helpful. That is going to protect the cardiac organ. And in case of emergency hypertensive situation, it is always better to have a non-injectable liquid epinephrine setup. Emergencies, yes, that is at what you call your epinephrine. It has to be there. Epinephrine, that is adrenaline, 1 milligram. What you call 1 gram per ml has to be there, and the dosage what we're supposed to use is only the 0.3 to 0.5 milligram should be given to the patient in case of emergencies. You have to inject either subcutaneous route or maybe the, what you call your IM route or even the sublingual at the base of the tongue can also be given, because in case of vascularity in emergencies, we have to inject into the vascular region. And whenever you want to give an IV, yes, this 1 ml ampoule should be diluted to the 9 ml of a saline. And only the 0.3, what you call 3 ml to 5 ml should be injected. That means the 0.3 to 0.5 mg you are using to in case of an emergency situations. Like what type of emergency you are going to encounter, maybe the anaphylactic reactions or maybe the status asthmatic condition. These two conditions, yes, the epinephrine is preferred. And this is also called as a life-saving drug. And if you use unnecessarily, what you call directly 1 milligram, maybe that itself is going to cause an arrhythmia to the patient. May patient end up with a mortality. That's the reason you have to use this drug. What you call this drug is called as a bi-edged sword drug. This drug is always used only to save the patient's life. That's why it's called as a life-saving drug, and it is the first in the list of emergency kit. So always use this drug in the 0.3 to 0.5 milligram, either IM or a subcute, or maybe dilute with a 9 ml saline and then inject as a 3 ml to 5 ml. Wait for some time, then again you have to use in the second time, because the drug is going to be destroyed easily in the body or metabolized, so that you have to use second time also. And the second drug of choice is that is antihistamine, that is what you call diphenhydramine hydrochloride is there, or maybe chloramine maleate. That is in case of anaphylactic reactions, you need to use this drug. Emergency drug, that is second type of in case of emergency, this is the second type of a drug. Then when we have this adrenaline, why to use this drug? Rather, antihistamine, this drug is the one which is going to only have a competitive antagonism with the histamine, which is already released in the body when the allergic reaction is there, which is not going to stop the release of the drug, what you call histamine, from the mast cells. That's the reason that you use only the antihistamine and epinephrine, that is only what you call for a life-saving, that is increase the cardiac output or maybe the vasoconstriction or a broncho, what you call dilatation. For that purpose, you should be using the epinephrine to save the patient's life. That is not a first drug of choice in case of a delayed reaction. It's only emergency anaphylactic reaction. But as a first drug is, second drug is, that is antihistamine should be used, and that is chloramine maleate or maybe the what you call diphenhydramine chloride also. And a third drug of choice in case of this situation, that is anaphylactic reaction, is the dexamethasone. That should be used, what you call as a third drug of choice in case of anaphylactic reactions. That is, this is called as a cell stabilizer. The antihistamine, what I told, is going to stop the, what you call, it is going to react with the, what you call, antagonist along with the histamine. Whereas this is not going to stop the release of the histamine for the release in the anaphylactic reactions. There is a reason you have to use the dexamethasone. This is going to prevent the recurrent episodes of what you call allergic reactions. And meantime, like maybe alternate drug, that is hydrocortisone, is also preferred. But in case of emergencies of anaphylactic reaction, these three drugs are first preferred, that is epinephrine and then antihistamine and then the dexamethasone. And the next drug in case of emergency situation, what type, that is analgesic. In the Western country, of course, they use what you call your central acting analgesic, morphine, all they use, or whatever, but that is not possible here in our center. So rather, we have to use what you call injectable form, that is diclofenac aqua form, that is in the deep IM it should be given, because in case of a severe emergencies, patient literally will have a pain that can lead to the increase in the blood pressure, that is because it will become a catastrophic. Rather, preferably we should always give an analgesic if the patient becomes a severe pain, that is going to cause a little problem for the patient. So next drug, that is diazepam. As I told, this is going to be the what you call your anti-epileptic drug, that is IV, it should be given, or preferred drug is nowadays, that is a midazolam, that should be given to the patient, that is the 1 to 2 milligram to the IV route. That is a what you call anti-epileptic drug. Next drug, that is going to be the anti-angina drug. This trinitroglycerin, these tablets are stored in the amber color bottle. That's the reason I told. Suppose if these tablets are going to be like maybe destroyed with a light reaction, that's the reason most of the time it is stored in the amber color bottle. and maybe sometimes it is ineffective. That's the reason they have to always test this drug when you're using this on the patient. They always want to be a short test. So if it is there, it means that drug is effective. Otherwise, it's inactive. That's the reason they have to ask the patient to get their own medication if your patient is treating with the, what you call, managing this angina patients. And that is sublingual tablet should be given to the patient as we discussed earlier. That is the next drug, what you're supposed to have in the emergency kit. So next drug is, that is dextrose. Dextrose, that is what you call 25% or maybe 50% dextrose, 20 ml should be given to the patient in case of a hypoglycemia. But that is if the patient is what you call not able to orally take this dextrose, then only we should think of giving this medication to the patient. And it is always better in case of diabetic patient also, we should think of injecting the patient, because hyperglycemia is not a problem, as I told earlier, only the hypoglycemia that is dangerous. That's the reason you should not hesitate in giving a IV dextrose to the, in case of a diabetic as well as healthy patient, to recover, help their patient recover from the syncopal episodes or any other problems. So next drug is, that is bronchodilator. Either you take the inhaler, meter dose inhaler, that is, or maybe injectable, that is diuretic, that is bronchodilator drugs. So these are the two drugs which are only meant to manage the asthmatic patient. So that's the reason these are all drugs, whenever you're managing or when you start treating any medically compromised patient, you should always check for these drugs in your emergency kit. That is either the inhaler drug or maybe it could be a, what you call, your bronchodilator in the your emergency kit. And the most important among all these things is oxygen. The type C cylinder should be there in the emergency setup so that any episode can happen. So immediately the patient should be given oxygenation, because otherwise that is going to be a biggest problem. What we call, the patient may suffer from the abnormalities, or what we call this patient recovery is not going to be there. So always you should have an oxygen cylinder in case of an emergency setup.